You could say that our story starts with John Travolta's film, Saturday Night Fever, about the disco craze. But that isn't really true. You have to go all the way back to Elvis Presley, to the Beatles, to rock and roll, and then finally comes disco. A very large, very lucrative new business of dance music. Maybe the biggest wave yet, because it certainly seems that more and more Americans are getting more and more into the disco scene.
This is the scene outside a New York disco called Studio 54. This is the place that's in with the disco crowd, except that these people are still out. Of course, Liza Minnelli and her kind of celebrities sweep right through the protective ranks of doorkeepers. One of the owners, Steve Rubell, works the door. He is choosy about who gets in, and that adds to the mystique and the desperation to be accepted. There is no live performance inside, no musicians, it's all records. Once inside, you begin to understand the attraction. For a disco to be a disco, you need a very heavy bass beat. The music has to have a hook. A hook is an easily recognizable theme or musical phrase, a vocal line. Something as simple as, I love you. And the amazing thing, the really different thing about the disco record business is that a record producer can hit big money without the record ever being played on radio. Now that's a new one for the record business, which has always relied heavily on radio for hits. Once a record is accepted by the clubs and by the dancers, it can easily make profits in the hundreds of thousands in the record stores before any significant radio play, solely on the basis of word of mouth from disco customers and a lot of advertising.
If, as the record plays, everybody leaves the dance floor, that's probably the end. On the other hand, if the dancers like it, it can be the beginning of really big money. There are more than 6,000 discos spread all across the country. Between what the discos take in and what they generate with the records, we are talking about an estimated $4 billion, that's with a B, $4 billion a year.
Bill Wardlow is one of the publishers of Billboard magazine, the Bible of the record business.
But I think today you have discotheques that are for the masses. They're for a blending of the people. It's, to me, a sociological revolution, very, very quietly bringing the people together. And through music, going to their feet instead of their heads, maybe. And I saw the reaction of people around New York, and I saw hits being made on the floor here. 150,000 singles were being sold in the New York market with very little radio play on the pop stations.
If you want to know about instant success, 28-year-old A.J. Cervantes, president of Butterfly Records, is a prime example. Chances are you haven't heard about Butterfly Records. Well, it was put together last summer, mostly with borrowed money. Since then, they put out five albums, four of them disco. Gross sales over the last 6 months are nearly $3.5 million.
Right now, the markets are strong. We're talking about New York. We're talking about Philadelphia. Pittsburgh came in yesterday for a strong reorder on the single.
Butterfly's latest releases are Too Hot for Love and Tuxedo Junction, a disco remake of old Glenn Miller songs.
But because of the kinds of promotion that we do, we have two people on the phone continuously talking to all the key disco DJs in the country. We have two people on the phone talking to all the retail outlets in the country. We begin to get this feedback.
Did you get a chance to listen to that Tuxedo Junction Chattanooga Choo-Choo single?
What time is your sales meeting?
Really?
It's an album for almost everybody. Oh.
The telephones never stop. The staff keeps pushing, keeps tabulating, keeps planning.
The adult contemporary response has been major. So we'd like to do an adult contemporary edit and remix with a little less disco feel, a little less hard
Which
kick drum.
Which tune do you want to do?
Chattanooga Choo Choo. And I think since we're doing Chattanooga, we should also do Moonlight Serenade.
How is a disco record made? The illusion that most of us have is that a large group of talented musicians and singers gathers in a studio to record a song. It doesn't quite work that way. In this session, the bass drum and other percussion have already been recorded. So have the strings, believe it or not, of the New York Philharmonic. That was all done on other occasions.
Now, a young musician introduces a guitar, listening on earphones to what's been recorded. Add the piano. This is Peter Brown's record, as composer, musician, and singer. This is for the TK Record Company, one of the biggest disco outfits. $7.5 million in gross disco sales a year. And here's how Peter directed the number called Dance With Me.
You got it.
He adds a track for the Moog synthesizer. Now watch Betty Wright do her first part. Keep dancing. And the second voice. Gotta keep on making me high. You gotta keep on making me high. And the third. Three for one. You gotta keep on making me high. You gotta keep on making me high. You gotta keep on making me high. Now the lead singer, Peter, with Pat Hurley. Get on your feet. Come on and dance with me. Say the word and I'll summon the band. Say the word and I'll summon the band. And the background vocals. The technique is called multi-track overdubbing. It is not new. What's new is that most all pop records now are made this way. But that's only the first step. John Ferrara is a producer, composer, and arranger for another label called Discomania. The selection is Mi Amore. His job at this stage is mixing 24 tracks of individual vocals and instruments into a finished product that will defy you to keep your feet from moving to the dance floor. He's invited disc jockeys from prominent New York clubs to listen and advise. Mixing is a meticulously slow and laborious process, taking many hours. Almost like composing on the spot.
Start off with just snare drum part. Just bass drum. Just bass drum. Nothing else. Leave this out. Just get this nice and hot, and this is going to be our focal point. Everything's going to be based around the bass drum. Okay? So let's get it as hot and as pulsating as we can. I don't want to... Top. Now listen right from the head. You let me know, man. If it's not cooking, if it's not making, we're not going to do it. If you don't have that feeling, then it doesn't matter.
It's got to have that drive.
Okay. Yeah, we're getting there. Hey, we'll work it out. We'll work it out. Relax.
They tried it out for the first time at a disco called New York, New York. It seemed to work.
Disco records come out on more than 400 different labels. Big producers, tiny ones. The competition is fierce. A whole label can completely disappear after one unsuccessful release. The promoters come by and visit the disc jockeys in their booths before the action starts at night, pushing their latest releases. If the DJ likes a number, he may give it a whirl. But remember, the DJ's own reputation is on the line, as well as the success of the record itself. As a result, only one out of every 10 records has any chance of being a hit on the dance floor or anywhere else. The rest die, never to be heard again.
Now, it's common knowledge in the radio station side of the record business that on occasion somebody will offer under the table money to a disc jockey to get a record started. Candidly, does that happen in this business?
Oh, never. This is, I'm telling you, this is the most unique situation. These people, the disco spinners, are building careers. They could not care less about what you have, you know, on your mind, financially or any other way. They are building careers, and all they care about is the crowd reaction. If you give them a record that the crowd stands up and screams for, if necessary, they'll pay you for it.
If the DJ, if he is being offered money, which I have never witnessed, but if somebody comes along and says, here's $25 or something, will you please play my record? If he does that too frequently and the record is no good, I'm not saying that he can pick all the hits all the time, but if he does that, he'll lose his audience and eventually he'll lose his job. And the clientele will go to another club. They'll go to a club where there's much tighter programming and where the music is that much more exciting.
You have to have, I mean, when the DJ is mixing from one tune to another, your intro has to grab them. It has to be dynamic right from the beginning.
Do you think of that when you're putting a record together?
You have to remember, there's a record before your record and a record after. And it really sunk in. That's so important. You know, no matter how close you are and how good you think it is, when you hear it in relation to two other records, you know, yours has to really, really jump off, or it just won't happen.
And there's a difference between radio and discotheques. In a radio station, personalities are made by the way they talk, you know, and their glibness in talking and how entertaining they are. But there's very little talking by the DJ in a discotheque. He'll try to sustain a mood by starting out. He may start out low or may start out high and bring you down and bring you back up again. But he has the task of spinning those records and segging from one record to another. So he sustains a mood or builds a mood on the dance floor. And with a combination of audio and lighting, he can create that mood. He can bring an audience's spirits way up, and then he can lower them down a little bit and then bring them up again.
How are you, John? John Ferrara, as composer and arranger, doesn't really have to do promoting, but we found that in the disco business, everybody is a promoter. They just can't sit around waiting for the phone to ring.
And we've been getting a really, really terrific reaction.
So on the basis of a good initial response, Ferrara brought the record around to a major store for display. How do they know how well they're doing? Well, record sales, of course, talk money. But the charts, the all-important rating charts, tell producers how often records are played, in discos, in homes, and eventually on the radio. The information, incidentally, is reported by thousands of outlets throughout the country and fed into computers. That's the best way to know what's happening with a given release, and equally important, what the trend is week to week. Ferrara felt the early response was even good enough to push toward a radio station. He remixed a short version. Radio generally likes short songs, with plenty of commercials in between. The pitch was made to Tom Morera, music director for WNEW-FM in New York. That's for the possible killing, the gold or platinum record, a half million or a million copies sold, the really big money. At the end of our filming, the Discomania album already was in such demand that the producer was looking for a bigger distributor. Jamie Edlin is the lead singer for Butterfly Records' Moonlight Serenade, and we asked her whether there was anything in all of this for the folks who still like romantic ballads.
When I listen, I'm going to try to be objective. When I listen to Moonlight Serenade, it still is a very romantic song.
The stars are aglow, and tonight how their light sets me dreaming.
And love, you know.
This may be just another American fad, another episode of silliness. But for whatever it's worth, it seems that a lot of people are having a lot of fun, and a few people are making a lot of money.
Pardon me, boy. Is this the Chattanooga choo-choo? Track 29. Boy, you can give me a shine. I can afford to board the Chattanooga choo-choo.